UGC University Grants Commission has come up with a new course that was mandatory to all research scholars in all universities. The course name is Research and Publication Ethics. This course being part of the PhD coursework examination, and all the students who are undergoing PhD essentially request to pass this course. So I'm trying to cover this course announced by the UGC, and I think research scholars will be benefited out of this video. And the course name is Research and Publication Ethics. So this is a syllabus given by the UGC. The syllabus is a very lengthy syllabus which covers philosophy and ethics of research, which include introduction to philosophy, definition, nature and scope, concept, branches, ethics, definition, like that. And the research and publication ethics part two consists of scientific conduct, which include research ethics and intellectual honesty, research integrity, then like some other fraud practices of research, falsification, fabrication, plagiarism, and also it covers duplicating publications, like fake journals, overlapping publications, salami slicing, and there is a fraud things which is happening, the reporting, misrepresentation of data, etc. And next, the third one is publication ethics. Publication ethics, which covers importance of ethics in publication and the best practices. And there are organizations which functioning in the field of means regulation or means taking leadership for better authentic publications like COP, WAMI, and there is a discussion on the conflict of interest, and there is a part which has been included like publication misconduct and unethical behavior and violation of publication ethics, authorship, contributorship, compliance, appeals, predatory publishers. Recently, you might experience a lot of predatory journals which has been caught by UGC and blacklisted. Okay, so that this part is been discussing here, and also the second part, like open access publication now is very important. Many of the journals, many of the publishers has started open access, gold open access publications. So that was discussed, and other things like copyright issues and softwares to identify predatory publications, and journal finder mechanism. Now you can see every journal has its own mechanism, every publisher has its own mechanism for journal finding. So every publisher has installed a journal finder mechanism in their editorial discovery option. So the course which will discuss the journal finder mechanism, and the next is publication misconduct again, like authorship, conflict of interest again discussing, and software tools to find plagiarism, Urkund, Turnitin, etc. And also the course discuss databases, indexation, like Scopus Web of Science. You might experience Scopus and Web of Science indexation, and what is the importance of indexation, and what is the importance of bibliographic databases, and research metrics like impact factor, etc., and H index, G index, etc. So I cannot discuss all the things in one video, but I will cover some of the portions in this, and I will cover the other portions in the later videos, which will be coming later. Okay, so let's start. Research ethics. So what is research ethics? Research ethics is a code of conduct for research. So there is a code of conduct for research that is essentially required. So across the globe, people are doing research, so there should be a code of conduct to guide, to lead, for authentic research. So research ethics deals ethical issues in the conduct of research. You know, there are fraud practices in research. We have to control those fraud practices to make to maintain the quality in research in across all universities in the world. So ethical issues in the conduct of research and the regulation of research. So there is a regulation is needed. So procedures and process of maintaining academic integrity. So all these things covers research ethics. So research ethics focus on academic integrity, maintenance of academic integrity, and there are regulations primed to maintain proper quality research. And there are ethical issues that has to be addressed. Means the UGC like organization has to address the ethical issues. So that this course was implemented, because all the scholars must understand the ethical issues in research and academic integrity. So the importance of academic integrity should be understood by the scholar. Okay, so this is about research ethics and importance of ethics in research. So why there is an ethics, research ethics? That is essentially because it ensures scientific progress of literature in the world. So over a period of time, we can understand that a progress of literature in the world. So every research, new research, there is a gap filling process in the existing literature and theories. So every day new research coming up and filling the research gap. So the progress of research. So the research ethics promotes the scientific progress of literature. Okay, then it promotes ethical behavior. Then it is good for scholars' reputation. Then it develop and regulate the research. These are the four main importance of this ethics in research. Okay. So. So next is the COP. It's a forum for editors of peer-reviewed journals to discuss issues related to the integrity of the scientific record. So it's an organization, and it is a forum for editors of peer-reviewed journals to discuss issues related to the integrity of the scientific records. So all the journals, all the publishers are a member of COP. All the important journals means I would not say that all the journals, all the publishers are member of COP, but all the major publishers like Elsevier, Taylor & Francis, Wiley, IGA Global, these major publishers are member of COP, and COP supports and encourages editors to report and instigate investigations into ethical problems in the publication process. Okay, the COP was founded in 1997 by a group of medical journal editors, and it is concerned about publication misconduct. COP investigates the publication misconduct like plagiarism, attempted or actual redundant publication, means duplicating publications, then attempt to pass off fraudulent data, means data manipulations, unethical research, breaches of confidentiality. So these fraud practices comes under the purview of COP. So COP is now, it is a limited company and it is incorporated as a company, and it is a like non-profit organization. So this is the importance of COP. So COP, it is a forum for editors. All the publishers are a member of this COP, and the COP power is their duty is to investigate publication misconduct like plagiarism, attempted duplicating publications, then fraudulent data, unethical research. So these fraudulent practices are comes under the purview of COP. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So role of COP, So, Committee on Publication Ethics, Committee on Publication Ethics Investigations and Reports. This is important. So, the journals involved in COPE are to be behaved according to the COPE Code of Conduct and best practices guidelines. So, all the publisher registered as a member of COPE, Committee on Publication Ethics, they are to be behaved according to the COPE guidelines. So they have to comply the rules and regulations set by the COPE. So major publishers are the member of COPE. This is another organization that is WAMI, World Association of Medical Editors. This is specifically applicable for the medical publications. It was established in 1995. It is pronounced as WAMI. It's a non-profit voluntary association of editors of peer-reviewed medical journals. The membership in WAMI is free, and all the decision-making editors of peer-reviewed medical journals are eligible to join. So membership is also available to selected scholars in journal editorial policy and peer review. So there are editors are also member of WAMI, and also medical journals are member of WAMI. So WAMI has more than 1,830 members representing more than 1,000 journals from 92 countries. So this is WAMI. So two organizations I have discussed, that is COPE and WAMI. COPE is a Committee on Publication Ethics and is a major organization. I think all the major journal publishers are member of COPE, like Elsevier, Taylor & Francis, Wiley, Sage, IJ Global, Emerald. These major publishers are member of COPE. Okay, so it is a listed company. I mean, it's a limited company, and it is a company which is not for profit organization. So the journal which is registered in COPE, the publisher which is registered in COPE, has to comply the rules and regulations of the COPE, and also they will investigate the fraud practices and research, and they will report to the respective institution in which that author belongs. Okay, if a particular author belongs to a particular university, and COPE will conduct investigation and report the matter, the fraud conducted by a researcher and intimated to the affiliated institution. That is very important. So the authors who are undertaking this kind of fraud practices should be careful, and the matter will be reported by the COPE to the particular affiliating university or organization. So that's the next is the World Association of Medical Editors. This is applicable for the medical journals as well as medical editors, journal editors. And next, goals of WAMI. WAMI facilitated worldwide cooperation and communication among editors of peer-reviewed medical journals. It improved editorial standards to promote professionalism in medical editing through education, self-criticism, and self-regulation. And it encouraged research on the principles and practice of medical editing. These are the goals of WAMI. So WAMI is applicable for medical journals and editors, and COPE is applicable for all the segments, including social science and scientific science researchers, journals and publishers. So next I will discuss on publication ethics. So there are a lot of concepts I can discuss here, and it has been part of the syllabus of research and publication ethics, which will be applicable for the PhD scholars who are undergoing the coursework examination process. Next, first one is authorship. Author is an individual who has made a significant intellectual contribution to the study. So everyone is interested to publish manuscript. So author or authors is there. Author is an individual who has made a significant intellectual contribution to the work. Okay, so authorship should be limited to those who have made a significant contribution. So the significant, the word significant is underlined. So significant contribution to the conception means the conception of idea and the design of the manuscript and the execution part of the manuscript and interpretation of the reports of the study. So the author essentially requires to contribute significantly to the conception, to the design part of the manuscript, execution part of the manuscript, interpretation part of the manuscript, etc. So transparency about the contributions of the authors is encouraged. Means if we can have three authors, two authors, four authors, five authors, but the authors has to contribute significantly to the manuscript. So there are criteria for an author. Four criteria must all be met to the credited as another author. So the criteria like substantial contribution to the study, conception, design, data acquisition, analysis, and interpretation, that already discussed. A substantial contribution is important. And also author contribute in the drafting and revising the article for intellectual content. And approval of the final version, means the final version has to be submitted to the journals. So uploaded to the journal, and the author has to given the approval and the agreement to be accountable for all aspects of the work. And there is a statement when we submit, upload the manuscript, and we are accountable for the all aspect of the work related to the accuracy and integrity of any part of the work. Okay, so the academic integrity shall be maintained by the author. So a criteria means the first one is substantial contribution. Second one is the drafting and revising of the article, his role of drafting and revising the article, and his role in approval of the final version, and his role in the agreement part of the accuracy and integrity of the work. And these criterias are to be complied by the author. And there are unacceptable authorship. Means, there are different types of unacceptable authors. First one is a ghost author. Ghost author who contribute substantially but are not acknowledged. Some people who are interested, you know, they are writing papers and they are charging money for papers, and these papers are published in the name of some other person. Means they are charging fees from the people who essentially requires papers for their academic criteria. So these people are known as ghost authors. Their name is not visible in the manuscript, but they get money from writing of papers. This is ghost authors. And there are guest authors who make no contributions. So there are people who make no contributions, but are listed in the top of the paper. You know, if their name is there, there is a chance of publication. This is also unacceptable authorship, that is a guest authors. And another one is gift author. Gift author is also not contributed significantly to the work, you know, junior researchers often feel pressure to put the name of these people because they are very junior, and these junior people career advancement or something like that depends on the senior people. So they will always mention the senior people name in the manuscript. These people are known as gift authors. Okay, so gift authors means they are not contributed significantly to the study, and guest authors, they are no contribution to the no significant contribution to the manuscript, but their name is there. Gift author is also not contributed to the manuscript, but their name is there. But ghost authors, they are contributed. They are a major contributor of the work, but their name is not there, but they are getting money. Okay, so these three types, these ghost authors, guest author, and gift authors are part of unacceptable authorship. This is a research violation of research ethics. Then unethical practices in authorship. Again, this authorship is very important in research ethics, and this I think so many times it was mentioned in the syllabus. Submitting a manuscript without the permission of an author contributor who contributed to the manuscript. There are again unethical practices. A person who submits the manuscript without the permission of the other authors or contributors, that's again illegal, unethical. And the order of authors is, again, there's a conflict between the people, you know, they, when we do publications, three or four person contribute a work, and finally there will be a clash. So who is the first author, who is the second author? So this order should be fixed in the beginning of the paper. That is very essential. And there is a definition also. First author is a person who conducts or supervises data analysis and proper presentations and interpretation of results, and put the paper together and submit it to the journal. And this is the first author. And co-authors, you know, makes intellectual contributions of the data analysis and contributes to data interpretation, reviews each paper draft, and is able to present results, define implications, and discuss study limitations, etc. So this is a contribution of the first authors and co-authors. And there is an international committee for journal editors' policies there, and their definition of the authors, you know, substantially contribute to the conception and design, acquisition of data or analysis and interpretation of data. And second one is draft the article or revise it critically for important intellectual content. And third one is give their approval on the final version to be published. So to be an author, you should fulfill all the above set conditions. Means all the conditions essentially requires to form part of an author. That person is called as an author. The first one is substantially contributed the conception and design, acquisition of data, etc. And he's been part of the drafting of articles, and he's also part of the giving approval on the final version to be published. Okay. So this definition is given by International Committee of Journal Editors Policy. Next is plagiarism. You know, plagiarism means copying when one author deliberately uses another work without permission or credit or acknowledgement. If a person copying some other's work without proper citations or without giving credit to the original author. So plagiarism takes different forms, from literal copying to paraphrasing someone else's work. It includes data, words and phrases, ideas and concepts copied is treated as plagiarism. Okay, so the levels of plagiarism, we can explain plagiarism different levels. So the editors are to be careful when the manuscript is being plagiarized or not. They have to test. There are tools available, you know, there are softwares, Turnitin, Check, and Orkund. These are the platforms, major platforms available for checking off plagiarism. So how much of someone else's work was taken? Few lines or paragraphs, pages, and full article. So they have to examine. The editors have to examine the things. And what was copied? There are things like results, methods, or introduction section. So someone else copying all these things, we have to measure the dimensions of copying, and there are different levels. I said the first one is literal copying, so reproducing a word by word for word in whole or in part without permission acknowledgement of the original source. This is literal copying, reproducing word by word. Okay, so without permission, without acknowledgement, without citation to the original source is called literal copying. And there is substantial copying. The substantial includes both quantity and quality of what was copied. If your work captures the essence of another work, it should be cited and credit should be given to the original author. Okay, this can include research material, process, tables, or equipment. So if you take someone else's work, we have to give the credit. Otherwise, it is being treated as copying and plagiarism. You are violating the research ethics. And the paraphrasing is also being part of the plagiarism. Reproducing someone else's ideas. While not copying word for word and without permission and acknowledgement of the original source. Means it is not copying word for word, but reproducing the ideas. Means through paraphrasing the person who is reproducing the ideas, but this person, you know, without acknowledging the original author. That is again treated as plagiarism. That is comes under the purview of plagiarism. So it is known as paraphrasing. Paraphrasing means reproducing someone else's ideas while not copying word for word without permission and acknowledgement of the original source. So paraphrasing is only acceptable if you properly reference the source and make sure that you do not change the meaning intended by the source. Okay, the meaning, you should be careful when you paraphrase, First of all, you have to give one the citation, and the second one is you should be careful. The meaning will not change. If you change the meaning without the permission of the, if you change the meaning and you have given the citation, but you should be careful that the meaning is the same meaning as intended by the original author. So if you change the meaning without after giving citation, again there is a violation of research ethics. So when you paraphrase, you should keep up 2-3 points. First one is you have to give the citation to the original author, and also if you paraphrase, you know, you should be careful, the meaning will not be changed. Okay, and rules for paraphrasing. And there are rules for paraphrasing. Make sure that you understand what the original author means. That's very important. I discussed already. Make sure that you understand what the original author means. Means you, first of all, you need to understand the contents written in the manuscript written by the original author. You know, never copy and paste words that you do not fully understand. Okay. So that's again important. Never copy and paste words that you do not fully understand. Think about how the essential ideas of the source related to your own work and cite the particular author. So first of all, you are writing a manuscript, you know, and you take the citations which is important to your work. Okay. So, and when you take the words, or when you take the ideas of other person, you have to give the credit to the original author. That is very important. And when you take something from the other author's, original author's manuscript, and you should be careful, the original ideas are to be taken, and you should be careful that the ideas intended by the original author should be like, you know, that ideas the same way you have to consider in your manuscript. That means you cannot change the ideas already given by the original author. So compare your paraphrasing with the source to make sure written in the meaning meant it by the original author. This is very important. This is a very, very important rule of paraphrasing. So you might be experienced, you know, some manuscript they have taken ideas from the other manuscript, but they're giving the citation which is quite different from the original author. So that's again unethical practice. So these points are important. Make sure that you understand what the original author means. Never copy and paste words that you do not fully understand. Think about how the essential ideas of the source related to your own work and cite the particular author. Compare your paraphrasing with the source to make sure you are retained the intended meaning mean by the original author. So next, rules for paraphrasing. This is discussed. So text recycling. This is again a very important concept. It's known as text recycling or self-plagiarism. What is it? Text recycling or self-plagiarism? So reproducing portions of an author's own work in a paper and resubmitting it for publication as an entirely new paper. That means already one particular author has a publication, and it is again reproduce some portions of that publications and submit it to some other journals. This is known as text recycling. You can find many of the papers published in journals form part of this self-plagiarism or text recycling. So after a particular period of time, it will be identified as text recycling. And again, the author will be, you know, penalized because of this text recycling will be caught by the journal. Okay. So text recycling, also known as self-plagiarism, occurs when sections of the same text appears in more than one of an author's own publications. Means the same text paper appear in different same text of one particular author's appear in other papers of the same author. You know, this is known as self-plagiarism or text recycling. This is also again violation of research ethics. So next, duplication of text and or figures again leads to be treated as plagiarism. data of others and theories of others, and without proper acknowledgement, is known as duplication, is again treated as plagiarism. This being part of plagiarism. So editors have to be careful when text recycling appears, how much text is recycled, where in the article the text recycling occurs, whether the source of the recycled text has been acknowledged, whether there is a breach of copyright. All these things should be careful by the editors while editing the papers. So another one is simultaneous submission. So simultaneous submission occurs when a person submit a paper to different publications at the same time. Okay, so what is it? Simultaneous publication occurs when a person submit a paper to different publications at the same time, which can result in more than one journal publishing the same manuscript. Okay, so it means a person submit a paper to different publications at the same time. So you know what will happen in future? The same manuscript will be published by two journals. Okay, so this is known as duplicate or multiple publication. So the same paper will be appeared in two three journals. Will be the impact of the simultaneous submission is again it's a violation of say this same hypothesis, same data, same discussion point, same conclusion is again violation of research ethics. So the editors have to be careful, simultaneous submission, and the authors also should be careful when they submit, one paper to one journal, and they have to wait till the process is over. And if the paper is rejected, they can submit the manuscript to the other journals as well. Okay, so the duplicating means simultaneous submission of the same manuscript to the more than one journal is again prohibited. And it is treated as the violation of research ethics. So let's go to the next slide. So simultaneous submission. So authors have to have an obligation to make sure their paper is based on original, never published research. And intentionally submitting or resubmitting the work for duplicate publication is considered as a breach of publishing ethics. And varying degrees of simultaneous submission, like literal duplication, partial but substantial duplication, or even duplication by paraphrasing. So the same manuscript is submitted somewhere else, or as part of the manuscript is submitting somewhere else, or the paraphrased manuscript is pub being published somewhere else. It's been the both the three things are part of simultaneous submission. So it can result in inadvertent double counting or inappropriate weighting of the results in a single study. See, it's a problem to the progress of research and scientific research. It's duplicating publications. Some others do like this, and they literally duplicate the publication. Sometimes they will take partial of element of some manuscript and submit somewhere else. And they, some other persons, they do like a paraphrased manuscript and submit it somewhere else. Okay, so this is known as simultaneous submission. There are research frauds. Research fraud is publishing data or conclusion that were not generated by experiments or observations, but by invention or data manipulation. Data manipulation, data cooking up, the same data, analysis and reporting two three thesis. Okay, the same data means one data collected data is there, and this same data will be used for two three thesis simultaneously. Okay, this is data duplication and data manipulation. They are cooking up the data, they are duplicating the data. These are part of research frauds. And types of research frauds: fabrication. So fabrication means making up research data. So without proper field experience or field survey, they are making up the research data and result and recording and reporting them. Okay, So this is a fabrication. This is against. This is treated as violation of research ethics. Okay. Then falsification is you know manipulating the research materials, images, data equipment, and processes. So falsification includes changing or omitting data or results in such a way that research is not accurately represented. So it's manipulating the research materials, images, data equipment, and processes. And it includes changing or omitting data or results in such a way that research is not accurately represented. I mean, some others already they have results, some results they hiding up, and some results they cooked up, some results they means giving some more insight, they cooking up the results for getting some good readership and all. Second, falsification of research, treated as falsification of research. And so two types of fraud generally. Fabrication means cooking up the data or making up the research data without proper field research. And second one is falsification. Here, manipulating the data, images, equipment, okay? This is known as falsification. So next type of next slide. So manipulating data is being treated as research fraud, intentionally modifying, changing, or omitting data. And manipulating data images, this can include research material, process, tables, or equipment. Manipulating a table, changing a table, changing data data in the table. Okay, your manuscript may be rejected because if the original data are not presented or misrepresented. So that some of the reviewers and journals asking for the data set as well as questionnaires. Okay, so manipulating data images, and is again second next important one is salami slicing. So salami slicing means one meaningful paper into several different papers is called salami publication or salami slicing. Okay, so it's usually practiced by researchers. They convert their thesis into 3-4 chapters. So this is also being part of this salami publication or salami slicing. So a meaningful paper into several different papers. So salami slicing involves breaking up or segmenting large study into two or more publications. So these segments are referred to as slices of a study. Okay, breaking up or segmenting large study into two or more publications. So if the slices of a broken up study share the same hypothesis, same population, and the same methods, and this is also a not acceptable practice. Again, it's a violation of research. Salami slicing. So the same slice should never be published more than once. Means so one thesis is published. Again, the contents of the thesis, convert into 3 or 4 papers, and again it is published in somewhere else, some journals. This is known as salami slicing or salami publication. This is also unethical practice in research. So next, we can discuss results, rules to avoid salami slicing. So avoid inappropriately breaking up data from a single study into two or more papers. This can be avoided. So be transparent when you submit a manuscript and send copies of manuscript closely related to the manuscript under consideration. So this includes any manuscript published, recently submitted, or already accepted. So this is again, rules to avoid salami slicing. Otherwise, the journal treated your manuscript as salami slicing, and there's a chance of rejecting your manuscript. So data fabrication, data falsification, this is already discussed. This concerns making up a research finding, manipulating research data with the intention of giving a false impression. This includes outliers. So usually, people do this. So this is again violation of research ethics, removing outliers or removing inconvenient results. Usually they, do it, they will remove inconvenient results. Results are to be cooked up for their convenience, changing, adding or omitting data points, etc. So this is the part of data fabrication or data falsification is again illegal. Should an author be banned and when? It's again another important one. So should an author be banned and when? So banning is not a policy endorsed by COP, Committee on Ethics, Research Ethics and Ethics and Publication. So they have no authority to ban an author. But you know, I already explained this COP will caught up an author for fraud practice and they will report about this author's falsification or fabrication details to the affiliated university. If an author, if Mr. X is affiliated to some university and the details of fabrication of Mr. X shall be reported to the university. And the university can take a decision that if a particular author do some fraud practices. So publishers are expected to correct the literature. So some exceptional cases, you know, the chief editor or editorial board has taken a decision, right, like refuse to review or accept papers of these authors. So they can take decisions like the author, the blacklist some of the authors, and that author's papers will not be reviewed. Okay. So the COP is an agency, you know, investigating all these things, Committee on Publication and Ethics, and this COP will report the fraud practices of a particular author to the affiliating university, the university in which the author is affiliated, and the university will take a decision to regarding the violation of academic integrity by a particular faculty or author. Okay, so the journal, you know, journal will take a decision, like some exceptional cases, they will not review the papers of those authors. Okay, so that's the case of banning of an author. So conflict of interest, COI, this is again important one. So when you submit papers in manuscript to the journals like Elsevier and Springer, something like that, you have to upload a conflict of interest. The authors have no conflict of interest, in financial or other personal considerations. That statement you have to be uploaded while submitting the manuscript. So this is very, again, compulsory part of requirement from the part of authors while submitting the manuscript. A conflict of interest is a situation in which a financial or other personal consideration from authors or reviewers have the potential to compromise. So authors and reviewers should declare and disclose all conflict of interest, if any. They have financial disclosures, they have some personal disclosures that has to be disclosed to the journal while submitting the manuscript. If there is no conflict of interest, that the thing they can disclose. Anyway, a conflict of interest is a statement that has to be uploaded along with the manuscript. Okay. So next, open access publications. This is very important. This is a part of coursework syllabus. So open access content is made freely available to under the terms of Creative Commons license. So when you submit a manuscript to journals, there are two, three options. The hybrid option is there, and open access is there, and standard access is there. Standard access means it's free of cost. Again, the author, no need to pay any fees, any APC article processing charges. The author can submit a manuscript free of cost, but the journal publish the paper, and the review, the readers, because it is closed one, the readers request to pay subscription fees for getting downloaded the article. But if you publish in open access mode, it is open to all. It is Creative Commons attribution. The license is, the copyright is given to the particular author. Means the thing is, if you publish in open access mode, you will get more citations and your paper will get more impact, because it is available to the all. It is available to the all. Anybody can download the paper and read it and understand, and they can cite it. So open access publication is usually, you know, subject to payment of an article processing charge, that is APC charge paid by an author, institution or funding body. If you are doing a project, you can get funding, you know, that funding can be utilized for open access publications. And also some of the universities, you know, they are giving funds for open access publications. There is a prepaid agreement with the publishers, and the university will give funds to the publication to the publishers for publishing the work of their faculties. So this is open access publications. So roots of open access, there are different roots of open access: gold open access journal, hybrid open access journal, and green open access archiving. Okay, gold open access journals. So I'm discussing the type of submission process. The gold open access journals, gold open access journals publish all of their content open access under a Creative Commons license. So most gold open access journals charge an article processing charge payable by the author or institution or funding agency. The work submitted to gold open access journals is subject to the same rigorous peer review process, okay, as traditional subscription journals. So there is a peer review mechanism, means anonymous review mechanism is same with the open access and the standard access. So open access is also have the same peer review process. Some of the misconception on the part of these academicians, like if they submit open access, is the peer review is very relaxed. There is nothing like that. So open access, I mean gold access journals have the same peer review mechanism in which is standard access. So after means success peer review process, the papers will be published. Okay. Then hybrid open access, both things means standard access and open access. The author can decide whether to go for traditional subscription mode or open access mode. If they submit open access mode, they have to they have to pay article processing charge after the peer review mechanism. Then what is green open access? Green open access is where an author published the article in any journal and then self archives a copy in a freely accessible institutional online archive known as a repository or a website. I mean the article content is available in the institution website, the others affiliated institution website. That is green open access is another option available to the author given by the journal. It is green open access. So why should you publish open access? It's important. So open access publications are popular nowadays because it can meet your founders' open access policy requirements. Means some of the projects, it is funded by UGC or ICSSR, and they want publications as a part of the project, and it should be available to the public for reading because they are giving funds, and with these funds we are doing the research, and the outcome of the research shall be published, and these publications can be read by all the people. So that they specifically request the publication in open access mode, that is Creative Commons license. So to meet your funders or open access policy requirements, greater control over rights to distribute and reuse the work. Okay, and in open access, the copyright is available to the author rather than journal, but the closed access or standard access, copyright is available to the journal. Okay, so the other do not get the copyright. So under a Creative Commons license, authors retain more control over rights to distribute and reuse their intellectual property. So leads to greater visibility and impact. Publishing your research open access means that more people can view and cite your work due to there being no barriers to access. Means everyone can download it. It is open access. It is available in the website of the journal, available in the website of the index. So the citation will be improved. Allows the general public to access the research. So general public can be understand because they can access the research, means they can read the research. So these are the importance of open access publications. So this is Creative Commons license. Open access publications, they are published in Creative Commons licenses, allow others to retain copyright of their work while allowing others to copy, distribute, and make some uses of their work. And they can share it and they can adopt it. This means everyone can read, everyone can share, everyone can adopt, everyone can transform, everyone can remix, everyone can commercialize. So this is Creative Commons license. Okay, this is article processing charge. The article processing charge is a fee charge to enable an article to be made open access on publications. APC can vary journal to journal, means the APC charges of Elsevier is different from Taylor and Francis. APC charges of Sage is different from Elsevier, means it is different from journal to journal. Okay, so for gold open access journals, APC is payable after acceptance of the article or before publications. For hybrid open access, means the article can be made open access on publication or can be requested to be made open access after publications. So where there is an article processing charge is already discussed. Open access prepaid accounts, institutions with open access prepaid account have fund with the publisher which can be used to cover open access processing charges in both gold open access and hybrid journals. So some of the institutions, they have prepaid account with the publishers, and the faculties, faculties of the institutions can, their work can be published and institution will be paid the publication charges to the publisher. So discounts is also some, some discounts is also there in this open access journals. So discount factor is also important in open access publications. So the publisher, has deals with some institutions, and some of the institutions, some of the universities will get discounts while publishing the papers. And selected low income countries may be eligible for discounted rates. And editorial board members, people are part of editorial work, and they are reviewing the other manuscript, they also will get some discounts in the process of these open access publications. And the other one is digital object identifier. This was important, DOI. So digital object identifier is a unique alphanumeric string that identifies content and provide persistent link to its location on the internet. So the publisher assigns a DOI when the article is published and made available electronically. So this this is a DOI number, and this is a identification of an article. So article can be identified with the help of DOI. So it has 10 digit number and contain a prefix and suffix separated by a slash, and the prefix is a unique number for four or more digits assigned to organizations. The suffix is assigned by the publisher, was designed to be flexible with the publisher identification standards. So I will show, this is the digital, this is a DOI number of this particular paper, and it will start https slash doi.org. So this can be available, you can see from the paper. The APC is, this is important thing, APC is charged only after your after the review process. So APC means you have to pay some article processing charge in the open access journals. So this charge, they will be asked to remit only after your review process is over. So after the review process, the chief editor understand that your paper is good to publish, and they will inform you to remit the article processing charge. Then only you need to pay it. Okay, this what does APC cover? Like, digital tools used to support the manuscript management and review process, typesetting, formatting, layout, online hosting, submission of the journal content. Means lot of people, employing in the publication process of journals, like plagiarism checks, third party softwares, and advertisement, online hosting, typesetting, and these charges, they need finance to do all these charges so that these APC charges will cover up. Okay, so these are references. Thank you. So I will give the other contents in the next videos. Thank you.